Modernism was a radical movement that first emerged in Europe during the Roaring Twenties. Its philosophy that living space should be simple, modular, and lack ornamentation was embraced by many North Americans and became known as the International Style. However, as the decades passed, many people grew weary of the stringent rules of modernistic living. They began to tire of living in geometric steel and glass boxes and yearned to add some traditional comforts to their minimalist spaces. Purists saw this as treason. Others saw it as progress. Can the International Style survive today?
The International Style developed in Europe in the 1920s. It was the work of a number of architects from different countries, but collectively, these architects produced buildings that were very rectilinear, very geometric, that abandoned history and historical references, that used light and space in very new ways and made a radical break with the past.
In 1991, architect Tonnet Sonnier took these modernist ideas and expanded them. His novel home in Barcelona, Spain, is an example of a style known as late modernism.
Well, my approach was related to the volume that could be constructed on the land and to the needs and requirements that I proposed for my own home. The distribution we needed came out of that.
Later modernism takes the forms that were developed in modernism and exaggerates and uses and manipulates and extends them in different kinds of ways. Buildings go out of being a simple box. Materials can be richer. We can have forms such as in the Barcelona house where we have textured wood and wood lattice work. And just generally, things are a bit more playful and loosened up.
Inside, Sonnier has repeated the traditional modernist box form in the living room, windows, and bookcases.
Desde el punto de vista arquitectónico,
from an architectural point of view, I would stress the simplicity of lines above all, combined with an attention to detail, to a love of things well made, and the organization of spaces from a functional standpoint. I think that these three elements can give the best architectural results. In this case, this is simply what I went for. I think that light and color are, of course, essential in architecture, but not in an independent or individual way. I think that light and color, along with space, are the three elements that have to shape architecture. If we forget one of them, we can make the mistake of not developing an architectural product. I think it has to be all three.
As human beings, I think we realize that complexity is part of our natural world. Whether we actually see it in our home or not, it depends on us as individuals. But in general, I think people want to see a level of warmth, a greater level of complexity, and a greater level of detail. Many people find the interiors and the spaces of the international style cold, perhaps because they've given up the complexity and richness that we're used to seeing. In a traditional home, we would have moldings, we would have trims, we would have other elements which add a level of complexity. And I think in time, like the Spanish home, adds some of that complexity back. There's a more subtle use of exterior materials, the use of some wood. There's a certain richness and complexity that's been added to the home.
The prosperity of the 1950s and 60s saw skyscrapers of steel and glass begin to dominate Canadian cityscapes. Modernism had become a fixture. But in our more traditional neighborhoods, a modular steel and glass structure on stilts is not always welcome. So architects have learned to adapt.
The housing market never really much liked modernism. People like to have steep roofs over their heads. They don't like flat roofs. They don't like large expanses of glass. And so what may have worked for commercial and industrial architecture never really was very successful for houses. A modernist home doesn't really fit very naturally into an established neighborhood. And so if one wants to build a modernist home, one has to make adaptations and respect the neighbor's materials and shapes and forms, and to some extent bring modernism out of its stricter geometry of before.
Modernism is defined basically, it's an attitude or an approach to building which treats wall surfaces and windows in a different way than had been looked at in the past. The residence was designed in the late 80s, built in 1990. Clearly a modernist design in a very traditional neighborhood. Two stories, stucco, black windows, light gray finish on the outside. Very formal, if you will, which is a little different than the international style purported, because asymmetry was a part of that particular style. You walk up the stairs and immediately walk into a space which is quite blocked from view from the inside, and then walk up another series of stairs around the wall that creates the privacy, and then the space just explodes. You immediately see that for some reason, these people have not put a big living room window in their residence, and that's because we wanted to celebrate the street from the corners of the house rather than from the front of the house. I'm attracted to modernism as an architect because to me it's very true, it's very pure. It doesn't try to be something else. The focus isn't in decoration and ornamentation, the focus is in spatial quality, positive and negative space, transparency versus opaqueness. That's the vocabulary of modernism. The flooring material used in this residence is maple, true Canadian maple, and it was selected because the other kinds of wooden floors in the marketplace have very strong grains, so we wanted something which was a little more subtle. Why would you invite people to come up to the second floor when it's not a public space? So we actually tucked the stairway around the corner. This home will stand the test of time because we avoided, in almost all instances, anything trendy. We didn't go to catalogs. We didn't go to home shows and see what the latest and greatest was. We simply decided to design and build a home which was truly in the international style. My favorite part is the sunken tub, which actually we didn't raise off the floor. We left at floor level, so you actually feel like you're walking down into, in essence, a pool. One of the greatest opportunities in the development of this design was that we could really celebrate an existing backyard that was fully landscaped, and that led to the creation of a large bank of windows along the back of the house as well, so that the yard came in and in went out, and the two actually work very well together.
The adaptations of the international style in this context, which I respond to, are the simple things that it does to recognize where it is. It's still part of a community, part of a street, therefore its doorway, its steps face out onto the street. And the simple device of the door knocker and those things which personalize the home are part of the street and the public domain. What is typically modernist, though, is that all of the living spaces have retreated to the back of the house, that they are not necessarily of the street. There's one room upstairs, but the other living spaces, kitchen and the living space, dining, are all facing out towards the back, as if the back is more important and somewhat detached from the street.
Modernism was so basic in its expression that really it accepted a variety of different materials brought together in a very limited number of ways. That it was, in a sense, a lot more pure than a lot of the questionable design that we're seeing today, particularly with, you know, going back to the 18th and 17th centuries and searching for something there that really is quite thin in its current application.
As we've seen, modernists can design new homes that satisfy the aesthetics of any traditional neighborhood. Even older homes can be transformed by architects into modern forms without losing their original essence. But can these dual identity homes be called truly modern?
Well, I don't know that it's actually all that easily distinguishable from the street. I mean, it's part of development of this time. It's a house that looks like it's from a Georgian era of building in Toronto. This house exemplifies my approach to design by, this area in particular with the kind of modern detailing. I'm very interested in modern architecture. I'm interested in the ideas of surface, minimalism, very reductive kinds of detailing.
What the Toronto House does is it takes a Georgian building from between the wars and it takes the back end of it and it turns that part into a modernist building. And what the architect has done has been to reflect features of the Georgian building in the new modernist part and features of modernism in the interior of the Georgian part. And in that way, I think she's created a very successful unity and a very successful whole.
Upon entering the house, you enter a vestibule. As you move further into the house, through the corridor, there's a set of steps down that lead you through another hallway into the kitchen area, which is the renovated garage. And then beyond that is the steel stair and the glass box that we added onto the back. What's important about that is talking about the steps and the kind of idea of transition from the older part of the house, moving in a kind of very generous way into the kitchen to make that gentle transition. The floor in the house before we started was all wood. We lifted that up and then we poured a terrazzo floor all the way through the ground floor. So there's a kind of continuity that's achieved by that helps to kind of unite the sort of more modern kind of detailing.
But it's very interesting the way both extremes start to influence each other. The cool uniform color scheme that's been used from the modernist aesthetic is carried through the front part of the house. It's not a Georgian interior. It's a very cool modern interior that's been essentially white painted over, and it's quite successful. Bits of detail from the Georgian or traditional part of the house have been moved towards the back. And so in the family room on the second floor, the fireplace replicates some of the details of the traditional part of the house. And so you had this kind of influencing of the two worlds.
What we did is we gutted the room. We sort of restated some of the kind of Georgian detailing in that room with a sort of a very low wainscoting that runs all the way around the room. It's one of those rooms that's really a mix between modern and Georgian. The other thing that we did is that there just wasn't room for closets, and so we actually punched through the exterior wall and hung the closets outside the building. My favorite feature is the natural light that one gets in the kitchen area, where the stair is, and the large glass wall is my personal favorite.
I think that modernism in this house demonstrated is changing. The client obviously is influencing the final statement. A true modernist would tear down the house and start over and create the glass box as the entire aesthetic. And in reality, the client or the owner bought this house probably because of the image, probably because of the neighborhood, probably because of the cultural context. And that's the precise thing that it undermines modernism as an ideal, that there is a cultural context, that there's a neighborhood, there's a street. And also there's a physical environment which has to be responded to as well. And in many ways, the house wants it both ways. It wants to be in the 90s, and it wants to be at the turn of the century at the same time.
In the 1950s, when modernism first came to North America, it was a radical style seen as being the property of a few fringe elements. But it quickly became accepted by the establishment, and it became a mainstream style. As we move towards the end of the 20th century, in the 80s and into the 90s, modernism became a source of forms and a source of ideas for architects. But it became extended and made much richer. Buildings broke out of the box, new shapes were allowed, buildings were allowed to respect their environment in a much more organic kind of way. And I think we have taken the best of modernism and left some of the less comfortable aspects of it far behind.
The way to ensure the success of modern architecture is really to deal with both the universal and the particular. And I think the universal is to deal with context, with the larger questions of satisfaction of people in the collective sense. And then there's the individual one of real satisfaction of making a particular place for, in the case of a house, for a particular homeowner. And the way you make them has to come out of, in my view, the technology and the climatic context.
Modernism is alive and well. It thrives in our cities, and rare glimpses of it can be seen in our neighborhoods. It was controversial when it first appeared in the 1920s, and it continues to be today. And for it to survive into the future, it must continue to adapt and reflect the way we live. I'm Holly LaRocque for Homes by Design.